Good evening. On behalf of Breakthrough Science Society, Karnataka chapter, I welcome you all to the third lecture in the lecture series to celebrate the birth centenary of Professor J.R. Lakshmana Rao. Professor J.R.L., as he is fondly remembered, is a pioneer in science writing in Kannada. He founded organizations such as the Karnataka Rajya Vignana Parishad. Throughout his life, he relentlessly worked towards taking science to the layperson. Today's lecture focuses on these aspects which were dear to Professor J.R.L. and very relevant to the times that we live in: science, technology, and of course, the society. Today's lecture is delivered by Major General S.G. Wombatkere. Mr. Sudhir Wombatkere was commissioned into the Indian Army Corps of Engineers in 1962. He has served in active army formations in combat appointments, as well as in executive staff training, instructional and technical appointments all over the country. In August 1982, he was responsible for design and construction of a unique motorable bridge over an ice body in Ladakh at 5,580 meter altitude. The President of India awarded him the Vishishta Seva Medal in 1994 for distinguished services rendered in Ladakh. He represented India at an international conference on human rights held in 1995 at the International Commission of the Red Cross at Geneva, Switzerland. He retired in 1996 in the rank of Major General. He was an adjunct associate professor of the University of Iowa, USA in international studies for teaching a course on sustainable development. He is a fellow of the Indian Social Science Academy. People like me who are from Mysuru, where Mr. Wombatkere now resides, and incidentally, also the city where Professor J.R. lived a good part of his life. We are all used to seeing Mr. Wombatkere's name in the newspapers, actively engaged in environmental, civic, and social activism. Mr. Sudhir Wombatkere, since you are someone who has worked in the field of engineering and also a man with deep social commitment and a lot of experience, we are all eager to listen to your lecture. On behalf of Breakthrough Science Society, I welcome you to this event, sir. A general note to our audience before we begin the lecture: since this is an online event, there could be connectivity issues. If there are any, please be patient. We will try to quickly resolve and connect again. Mr. Wombatkere, I now request you to deliver the talk on science, technology, and society. Sir, can you hear me? Please give us a moment before we start. I think there are some audio problems at our end.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, to our audience, please be patient for a moment. We are trying to rectify the audio issues at Mr. Wombatkere's end. We will soon start with our lecture in this series. As always, we appreciate you participating in this event. We have already covered two such events. One was on the evolution and the importance and significance of evolution. That was our second lecture, and the first one was in the aerospace areas. Both these videos are available on Breakthrough Science Society Karnataka chapter's Facebook page. You could go to the video section and watch these earlier lectures there. We are back on. Sudhir sir, can you hear me?
I hope I can be heard.
Yes, you are audible.
Good evening to everybody. And I am very honored and happy to be on the air this evening. And I am grateful to the Breakthrough Science Society, Karnataka State Unit, for giving me this opportunity. When I was invited to speak at a memorial lecture for late Professor J.R. Lakshman Rao, I was simultaneously sad and pleased and humbled. I was sad remembering the passing away of that noble soul, pleased that I could pay a tribute to his life and work, and humbled that I should speak in memoriam of a person whom I hold in such high esteem. When I came to Mysore in 1996 to put down my roots after a gypsy existence of 35 years in army service, posted to a different unit at a different place every 2 or 3 years, which is not unusual in the army, I knew just about half a dozen people. But as I began to participate in the life of Mysore, Asha and I were blessed and fortunate to get to meet and know people from a wide spectrum of society, from academicians to activists, to media persons, to industrialists, to simple small traders who had similar values and thoughts and thought on similar lines. Prominent among the academicians with whom I had the good fortune to come in contact was Professor J.R. Lakshman Rao. Professor Lakshman Rao's simplicity and affectionate nature captivated both of us. Although he was 20 years my senior in age, he never stood on the false high horse of age-related wisdom. He was open to discussion and argument on any subject whatever. And he was so well-read and well-informed that every interaction with him resulted in my going home better informed and educated in some way. Professor Lakshman Rao was a highly respected teacher of science. For him, science was a destination, and I have discussed with him matters like the social effects of nuclear energy and of genetic modification. Every discussion left me with much to think and much to write about. So today, with the memory of some of my interesting discussions with Professor Lakshman Rao, I will speak on science, technology, and society in the broad sense of human knowledge. Let me begin by saying that the arguments, opinions, and discussions in my talk are not meant to be judgmental. So if by inadvertence I tread on someone's corns, I ask forgiveness in advance. I will attempt to put a perspective on some matters concerning science, technology, and society. First, let us look at science within the spectrum of knowledge. From time immemorial, knowledge has increased only by observing, wondering, doubting, questioning, discussion, dissent, argument, debate, and all based on a fundamental humility that one's knowledge and perspective are necessarily limited, necessarily not final. Also, always consciously distinguishing between knowledge and opinion, always with a childlike combination of surprise, awe, and curiosity at what our senses reveal to us and which we do not understand. We know that science consists of at least three things. One, science is a human endeavor to understand the structure of the universe, including ourselves and how it works. Of course, determining the purpose and meaning of the existence of the universe is outside the scope of science as we define science. Two, science is an intellectual activity of practical, systematic study of the behavior of the physical and natural world using observation and experiment. Three, science is the process of hypothesizing, reasoning, and theorizing through questioning and accepting questioning and seeking explanations formulating and solving problems to constructively enlarge the body of human knowledge. We therefore have science as endeavor, as activity, and as process. Science, as we understand it today, is a systematized body of knowledge gained, corrected, and augmented by observation, by deduction, inference, and experimentation, using the methodology of verifiability, reproducibility, and falsifiability, and importantly, by questioning, and even more questioning. So we have questions at individual levels. The scientific method may be used to acquire knowledge in diverse fields, recognizing that human knowledge spans a huge spectrum, which has been compartmentalized for convenience as natural sciences, humanities, engineering and technology, arts, and so on. Within each knowledge compartment, there are further compartments of specialization and super specialization. For example, plasma physics or theoretical physics are specialized fields of study and research within the broad discipline of physics, which is in turn within the broader area of the natural sciences in that enormous spectrum of human knowledge. Viewing knowledge as a spectrum leads one to comprehend the essential interconnectedness of everything in our universe, and it thereby leads to more curiosity and more questioning, and the realization that as one gains deeper and more knowledge, it actually expands the horizons of what we do not know. A serious seeker of knowledge knows that as one goes deeper into any subject, there are overlaps and linkages with other disciplines. Perhaps methodical pursuit of curiosity leads one to the subject which we label as philosophy. The word philosophy comes from the Greek philo and sophia, meaning love of wisdom. But we understand it broadly as the study of the most basic and profound matters of human existence. It is worth recalling that in Indian thought and philosophy, jnana or wisdom is valued above vijnana or science. Likewise, viveka, the wisdom enabling discrimination, is superior to vidya, which is connected with knowledge. Knowledge is the result of processing information, such as our ancients who observed the stellar bodies and created a body of knowledge which we name as astronomy. Thus, information, today we also use the word data. Information, when processed, leads to knowledge. Knowledge with further processing and thought leads to understanding. Understanding leads to broad internalization, and internalization with deep contemplation leads to wisdom. Put another way, vijnana may lead to jnana and vidya may lead to viveka, although obviously there is no guarantee for either. Indeed, before knowledge was compartmentalized as it is today, ancient and medieval thinkers and scholars in all societies were philosophers engaged in multiple fields of thought and endeavor. Perhaps that is the reason that the highest level of study in the sciences, humanities, arts, and so on in modern times is called Doctor of Philosophy or PhD. Ancient Indian tradition is replete with men and women who observe the planets and stars and their rising and setting, eclipses, and so on over long periods, recorded their observations, and then set about finding explanations to fit their observations. They were the first astronomers, and they developed the tools necessary to systematize knowledge. One of the intellectual tools was mathematics, and one of the physical tools was the gola, an earth-centric crafted astrolabe for visualization, better understanding, and teaching. Of course, we now know that Earth is not at the center of the observable external universe, that it is one of several planets revolving around our sun, which is just an average star in our galaxy. And our galaxy is just one among millions of galaxies and groups of galaxies in our perpetually expanding external universe. And I use the term external universe because that is what we observe when we look outside ourselves. Observation and study of the external universe inevitably leads to questions like, When did this universe begin or come into being? Was the universe created or did it always exist? If it was created, who or what created it and why? What is the space into which the universe is expanding in time? What is time? Did space come into existence before matter or time? Is there anything beyond both time and space? And so on. There are many questions. Such inquiry brings forth some fundamental questions of what are time, space, and matter. Addressing such questions transports the thinker outside of the methodology of science, scientific rigor, into philosophical speculation, not excluding the ideas of a supreme being, of God, of religion. These are outside the scope of today's talk, so I will leave this and proceed to the idea of an internal universe, where we run into similar thoughts of an unknown or multiple unknowns. The internal universe may be understood as what is contained inside of matter. Science and technology today have created amazingly refined and sensitive instrumentation, which has enabled the process of hypothesizing, theorizing, experimentation, and observation of matter beyond the capability of the human senses. Quantum mechanics is a fundamental theory in physics that provides a description of the physical properties of nature at the scale of atoms and subatomic particles. Today, we know that matter behaves differently at different scales, ranging from the infinitesimally small femto, ascending to pico, nano, micro, and milli scales of the internal universe, to the physically large scales of kilo, mega, giga, tera, and peta scales of the external universe. Inevitably, curiosity combined with mature thought and contemplation leads to scientific and philosophical inquiry into concepts and abstractions such as zero or nothing, absence of matter, space, negative and positive infinities, and an infinity of infinities. From observations, we develop knowledge. But learned and informed discussion continues, whether theory precedes observation or observation precedes theory. Put another way, we observe something that we are expecting to observe, or we serendipitously observe something and then posit a theory to explain what we have observed. It brings into focus the issues of subjectivity and objectivity in science. What is scientific truth and reality? And the meaning of the word consciousness. Similar questions as with the external universe arise concerning space and time and matter, and of alternate universes or parallel universes. Additionally, we encounter questions such as life. Concerning life, what is life? Is there meaning to life? Why was life created? It is axiomatic that the deeper one goes into any subject, more questions arise, and the expanse of what is unknown increases, and that it will remain so in perpetuity, since every increase in human knowledge opens avenues of unknowns. This leads to the thought or conjecture that beyond the unknown lies the mysterious universe. Please note that I carefully avoid using the word mystical. It is a mysterious universe. A serious thinker may agree that there will always remain something which is unknown, perhaps even unknowable, that is beyond human experience or understanding, concerning both the external and the internal universe. Also, that the objective ideas of external and internal are pegged to the physical, intellectual, and psychological subjective self, ourselves. Thus, the origin of the self and the origin of the external and internal universe remain a mystery, howsoever far scientific inquiry and knowledge advance. Answers to questions simply lead to more questions. I must emphasize that I only speak of scientific inquiry and knowledge as understood by natural human intelligence. At this stage, I will not venture into the questions that arise if one considers an outcome of current cutting-edge science and technology, namely artificial intelligence or AI, which has the potential to transform not only our world as we understand it today, but transform humanity itself at individual and social levels. So now let us look at science and society. The practice of science needs scientists. Perhaps many scientists have not questioned the long-held belief that science, as a study of the universe, of the behavior of the physical and natural world, is independent of subjective, moral, or ethical considerations of what is right and what is wrong, what is desirable, what is undesirable, and is meant only to discover the truth or reality. Also, it is generally accepted that science is independent of a scientist's personal life or preferences, likes and dislikes, and reveals objective reality. However, at the subatomic level, it is known that the act of observation influences the entity which is being observed. Certainly, at this extremely minute level, the moral ethical mindset of the observing scientist will not affect, for example, an electron. But most importantly, it does question the idea of objective reality. Let us now turn to society, of which every scientist is a member. A large majority of the 7.3 billion humans on our planet spend much of their time and energy to simply survive in the extremely difficult social, economic, environmental, and political conditions in which they live. Such thoughts and questions as we have just been discussing, like time, space, matter, self, consciousness, etc., would surely not interest these people or even be relevant to their lives. But it should not be difficult for scientists who do entertain such thoughts and questions, or others who are privileged with social, economic, or educational advantage and capacity, who may spend time thinking on these matters, to understand that it is a larger social structure which includes these other 7.3 billion people, which supports their own living and working and enables their intellectual pursuits and intellectual growth. Some questions which may arise here are, one, what reciprocal support or service do such privileged persons, scientists included, give to other members of their society? Another question is, at a moral ethical level, do privileged persons have a duty to society, which comprise millions of people of various professions and occupations who keep our society functional? Do they have a duty to society which enabled them to acquire such specialized knowledge and attain superior intellectual levels and social status? At a personal level, I may ask, does my work benefit the poorest and weakest? Or does benefit to the poorest and weakest matter at all to me? Such moral ethical questions are very difficult to answer, but the difficulty should not stop us from understanding that such questions exist and may pose a dilemma for the most sensitive persons amongst us. It is undeniable that many of us from different professions and occupations, including those pursuing science, who are in a privileged socio-economic situation, we genuinely believe that we have reached our intellectual level due to our own intelligence, our own abilities, our own efforts. This mindset fails to recognize the interdependency of members within every society and of every social unit like a family upwards within society, and the necessity of and responsibility for reciprocity of support and service for a healthy society. Let us look at the social effects of science. People show curiosity in different ways for different reasons. An old person may ask, how many children do you have? What is your age? Why are you unmarried? And so on. Inquisitiveness, perhaps. A commercial executive may ask, which brand of toothpaste or which make of car do you prefer? And why? Curiosity is not unnatural, whether personal or professional. But what motivates scientists is intellectual curiosity. Scientific curiosity is usually understood as an ethically neutral, morally neutral appetite for knowledge, which is not constrained by beliefs and rules. This is typified by a child's innocent questioning as part of the process of learning about the people and the world around as he or she grows intellectually and emotionally. Scientists ask themselves why, how, when, what for, etc. about the natural and physical world around them to research, learn, and grow intellectually and professionally. However, the answers that the research provides always have a purpose or are inevitably put to use. For example, to publish a paper, to show progress or success in the research work, to raise personal or institutional status, and so on. Even when a scientist experiments, investigates, and researches as objectively as possible, he or she does not live apart from the scientific fraternity or the larger society. The scientist, like any other professional, is dependent on both in multiple ways. Science is a social discourse and therefore has moral and ethical dimensions, even if the initial curiosity was ethically and morally neutral. Science and scientific research is a collaborative social process. It builds on ideas and thoughts of predecessors and peers, even from outside the specific discipline. Collaboration is demonstrated by the fact that the creative and original ideas of great scientists are worked upon by other scientists who bring the idea to light through detailed checking out by review and authentication, explanation, mathematical modeling, and so on. All this makes the original great idea understandable to others and to gain general scientific acceptance. Thus, all scientists, ranging from fresh graduates to mature researchers at the forefront of knowledge, are dependent upon their immediate scientific fraternity and also upon the larger society of which they are a part. Knowledge itself is an outcome of the intellectual and social activity of the whole community. As for other professions and occupations, society supports scientists and science. When doing research in so-called pure or fundamental science, the scientist no doubt derives personal satisfaction and a sense of personal achievement. But especially in present times, a scientist also naturally has material expectations, such as recognition, award or prize, research grants, consultancy, authorship, promotion in the scientific hierarchy, and so on. Thus, both at individual and social levels, an undeniable element of subjectivity or external influence enters into what is researched and the outcome of the research also. Let us see how science has consequences. Some argue that science, which seeks facts concerning the real universe, is impersonal, while ethics is a discourse about values which are personal, and hence science and ethics should be considered separately. Let us examine this idea. The outcome of scientific research is widely available when the research paper is published. Especially in present times of information explosion, technological capability, and commercial advertising and marketing skills, published scientific research rapidly translates to a product or a process or a service, and perhaps also a patent, and is used by society in some manner. That is, sooner or later, the outcome of research has consequences, even if guessing at their direction and magnitude and social environmental effects may not be possible. Because scientists are embedded in society, scientific research has social consequences, positive or negative, great or small, near or distant in space and time. I will quote just two examples to demonstrate two things. One is the certainty of consequences, and the other is the unpredictability of the nature or scale of the consequences, such as health or safety. The first example. In 1938, Lise Meitner and Otto Frisch revolutionized nuclear physics when they discovered nuclear fission, observed when a uranium nucleus splits and releases energy, which conforms to the by now famous E is equal to mc² formula. This discovery led to demonstrating that sustaining a chain reaction could release huge energy and thereby directly to development of a nuclear bomb. There was no way in which these Meitner or Frisch could have imagined, leave alone predicted, that their discovery would lead to scientists and technologists developing a nuclear explosive device that could change the world. Lise Meitner and even other downstream scientists were morally and ethically devastated when the apocalyptic destructive capacity of the atom bomb became clear from early calculations and experiments. Long before the bomb was tested on 16 July 1945 and used as a catastrophic weapon 3 weeks later on the Japanese people of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Another example is genetic modification, GM, or recombinant genetic engineering. The scientific discovery in 1950 of the double helix structure of DNA by Francis Crick and James Watson, based on data recorded by Rosalind Franklin, led scientists to develop and use tools and techniques to study DNA. This led to laboratory techniques of transferring genetic material, now called gene transfer, between different species which, in nature, would never exchange genetic material for reproduction. GM was brought to public attention in our country through introduction of BT cotton, where BT stands for Bacillus thuringiensis, a soil-dwelling bacterium. As far as GM is concerned, scientists worldwide are divided into two broad warring schools. One school holds that GM of food crops on a commercial scale will increase crop yield and solve the food and nutrition problem for a growing human population. Scientists of the other school question the validity of these claims, and they demand transparent peer-reviewed research on allergenicity and toxicity of GM organisms or GMOs, toxicity to mammals. Their independent research shows that GMOs once released into the environment cannot be recalled. The GMO thus constitutes a threat by genetic contamination of natural crops, destruction of genetic diversity, and since long-term outcomes are unpredictable, a credible threat to global food security. Further, they fear unpredictable global scale and species scale negative consequences and allege corporate interests influencing government policy to promote GMOs. This GMO war has ethical and moral dimensions due to its possible global consequences. Thus, science and technology are changing societies and our ways of life and our ways of thinking, including affecting global environment and ecology. The claim that science is neutral is no longer tenable because it has ethical and social consequences. The fact of essentially unpredictable consequences of scientific and technological research leads the researcher to the moral or ethical dilemma of whether he or she should pursue a line of research which he or she thinks may open a Pandora's box or which crosses legal or religious boundaries. However, it is difficult to fault such a researcher for feeling or believing that if he dropped that line of research, some other person, perhaps a rival or competitor with a different understanding, would pursue it anyway and thus rationalize continuing the research. This dilemma agitates some scientists in, for example, the field of embryonic stem cell research, in which extracting the cells from a living embryo destroys the embryo. So we have a challenge in coming times. Our species, Homo sapiens, dominates planet Earth. Our numbers have grown exponentially, 7.3 billion and counting, along with our ability to identify and harness sources of energy and use energy at enormous scale enabled by scientific knowledge. This is just one of the reasons for our considering ourselves as a unique and superior species and naming ourselves as sapiens. The most important source of energy for every national economy is oil. Oil itself or its agricultural, industrial or service products are used either directly or indirectly by every individual. Thus, Ours is an energy-intensive civilization. Every single liter of oil consumed by anybody for any purpose whatever, at any place whatsoever, results in carbon and other emissions. At the humongous global scale of use of oil over the past century, the emissions have caused a greenhouse effect, causing global warming and consequent global climate change. Scientific findings have succeeded in influencing world leaders to consider measures to limit carbon emissions to slow down climate change. Sadly, many world leaders continue to prioritize profit and political power over the general good, mostly due to ignorance and arrogance of power. This, even while scientists are finding alarming signs of polar ice melt and ocean bed methane emissions, which presage a rate of global warming far exceeding previously computed rates. On the other hand, corporate-influenced governments are speeding up the treadmill of development based on the paradigm of perpetual economic growth, predicated on the use of more technology, more fuel. Along with that, more and more land is being acquired for industrial and infrastructure projects, displacing self-sustaining farming communities or forest-dwelling communities, and also destroying natural carbon sinks. This is a double whammy on global warming, quite apart from the deleterious social fallout. Today, scientists are discussing measures for societies to adapt to changed climatic conditions and the measures which need to be taken to mitigate the effects of climate change. Ideas such as carbon capture, carbon sequestration, and carbon credits are being tossed about in world fora. All these and others seek to use more energy-intensive technology to solve problems caused by energy-intensive technology. Scientists would do well to heed Albert Einstein, who is reputed to have said that problems cannot be solved using the means which caused the problem in the first place. Notwithstanding, some nations, including our own, have created a national action plan on climate change. Thus, it is well understood that global warming and climate change are real threats to life on the planet, especially including human societies and maybe even our species. I've got a couple of final questions. During my talk, I have raised several questions for which there are no definitive answers, but I will raise a couple of final questions which I will leave for the discerning listeners to contemplate. The foregoing discussion concerns our knowledge and practice of science and technology being a major causative factor for global warming and climate change, leading to threatening the continuance of our societies or even of Homo sapiens. It raises two questions. The first is, why in the first place are we discussing an existential threat to Homo sapiens? And the second question is, are we presuming on the desirability for the continuance of Homo sapiens along with this growing body of human knowledge? I will not even attempt to address these questions because I am certain that I do not have the intellectual competence to handle them. In all humility, it brings to my mind the saying that there are more questions which a fool may ask than a wise man can answer. In conclusion, the foregoing discussion is not meant to deride or minimize or trivialize the truly phenomenal advances in science and technology and their addition to the body of human knowledge and their contribution to the human condition. Nor is this a Luddite sideswipe at science and technology. It is undeniable that over the years, millions of people have surely benefited from the economic development flowing from scientific and technological knowledge and practice. But one needs to also recognize that as many, if not more millions, have been victims in various ways of that very development, besides other global effects. The fact is that we have developed amazing scientific and technological capabilities, but we have fallen woefully short of developing matching social skills. Nobody can argue that science and technology are undesirable. There are demonstrated undeniable benefits, but we should not lose sight of the unpredictability of the manner in which humans who are in positions of socio-economic political advantage continue to use the knowledge generated by science and technology to the detriment of society, like waging war and research on new weapons. Scientists like Professor J.R. Lakshman Rao, who had no stake in science beyond the academic and who practiced science on a bedrock of moral principles and ethics, are in a rapidly shrinking minority. Professor Lakshman Rao was a socially committed scientist. He expressed scientific thoughts and ideas lucidly in simple Kannada language for people of all ages to popularize science in society. His questioning went beyond scientific questioning into the wider sphere of social life. Today, science for its own sake and scientific and technological inventions and innovations providing solutions in search of problems are being used by commercial interests to spur endless quantitative economic growth in our political economy. This inevitably makes science and technology socio-economically biased. Over recent decades, runaway industrialization and energy and resource use based upon and for science and technology have been identified as the cause for global warming and climate change. This poses an existential threat for human societies, if not for humanity itself. It is not difficult to imagine that unless the state revises policy to ensure that science and technology and their management serve a clearly defined beneficial purpose for the poorest socio-economic sections of society, societies will continue their downward spiral of species extinction due to a widening and deepening socio-economic gap and consequent social tensions. This, when the wealthy upper crust, the so-called 1% in society, own and consume more and more at the cost of the bottom growing deprived majority. The result is that the socio-economic gap will only widen. Poverty breeds discontent and leads to social tensions. It does not require rocket science to understand that unless science and technology and their management serve to benefit the poorest sections of society, society as a whole will continue its downward spiral, besides exacerbating global warming and climate change. To imagine that the rapidly worsening socio-economic disparity can be remedied or even mitigated by more science and technology and more economic growth is daydreaming at best. Perhaps folly is a more appropriate word. What is called for is nothing less than radical change in the mindset of persons in power and authority to use science and technology for social benefit in their respective societies, rather than for social control to which we are being increasingly witness. Scientists and technologists might consider assuming a more proactive social role in this. Thank you for a patient listening. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. That was indeed an insightful talk. You spoke eloquently about a complex subject, the interactions of science and society with each other, and how science always has ethical and moral questions to answer, however objective it aspires to be. Thank you also for underlining the necessity of taking science and technology to the poorest sections of the society in order to bring inclusive development. I see many of the participants in the audience, they have liked this talk and commented that this was indeed a very thought-provoking talk. Thank you once again. On behalf of Breakthrough Science Society, I thank you, Mr. Sudhir Vombatkere, for being part of the J.R. Lakshman Rao Birth Centenary Year Lecture Series and delivering an insightful talk. Thank you. There are comments flowing in from our audience. How well Mr. Vombatkere connected science and living in the society. Indeed, a very interesting talk. If there are no questions, I think it is it's time to wrap up this session. Yes, definitely. We could definitely wait for a minute. If you have any questions, please post them in the comment section, and we could get Mr. Sudhir Vambatkare to comment about them. Mr. Vinod says that a researcher in pursuit of science need not burden himself with ethical matters, may show a way out of future problems after going through necessary refinement. Indeed, a lot of food for thought. We need to continue this dialogue. We are really glad that, you know, this talk has sort of made you all think about the different dimensions of science and what are the implications on society, etc. Mr. Satish asks, can you just comment on limitations of science? So this is a question for Mr.
I believe there is a question from the audience on what are asking for a comment on the limitations of science. I don't think science is limited. What is limited is the understanding of us human beings and the way in which we can understand the limits of our own understanding and of understanding our puniness in this huge universe. There are no limitations of science. The limitations are human.
Okay.
I hope that answers the question.
It does. All right. So there is indeed a question by burning scientists with ethical issues. Their work gets derailed. This is another question I think Mr. Vinod is would like to ask the speaker for his comment.
Oh, okay. I see the next one about, I'll read it out. In pursuit of science, a researcher need not burden himself with ethical matters. What seems abhorrent now may show a way out for future problems after going through necessary refinements and modifications. An unethical fallout of a scientific research and development has to be controlled or quelled by the government or society through debate and law. By burdening scientists with ethical issues, their work gets derailed. I think the point here is whether we want government to quell or control anything. The moment there is control or quelling, as this person has used the word, it removes freedom. And what scientists need is freedom. So this has got to come, the the check, the ethical and moral check, has to come from within the person, the individual scientist who is researching. We can't expect somebody else to impose limitations and direct and control research. That is precisely the point I was making, is that the limitations come from within. We have to understand our own responsibility as members of society and do our research accordingly.
All right. Thank you. Are there any more questions from our audience? All right. So indeed, as Mr. Satish has commented, this was an illuminating talk. Thank you so much, Mr. Sudhir Ombedkare. It is indeed a pleasure to have introduced you to the audience and been with you through this event. On behalf of Breakthrough Science Society, I thank you for being part of the J.R. Lakshmana Rao Birth Centenary Year Lecture Series and delivering an insightful talk for all of us. Breakthrough Science Society would also like to thank Professor Lakshmana Rao's family for all the kind support they have extended towards this event. I would like to thank Deepthi, who is working behind the scenes and providing technical support for this online lecture. A quick note. I think there is just a last comment here. I'm going to read it out before ending the session. Wouldn't it be right to say that science looks to understand the world around us, comes up with results, society uses these results in ways that may lead to problems, but to solve them we would need scientists again? Ma'am, if this is a question, I'm just going to post and let Mr. Ombedkare talk about it a little bit before we conclude the session. That would be the last question that would be taking for this evening.
Okay, I see a last question. Wouldn't it be right to say that science looks to understand the world around us, comes up with results, society uses these results in ways that may lead to problems, but to solve them, we would need scientists again? Social problems cannot be solved by scientists, cannot be solved by science and technology. Social problems have to be solved by human beings using their interpersonal skills. What has happened in today's society is we have got far too much of advance on science and technology, and we have been losing our social skills. In fact, I have heard that in some Scandinavian country, they are running a course. This is a little difficult to believe, but I believe it is true, that they're running a course on how to deal with your brother. That means they are running a course to tell a man or a woman how to deal with her brother, how to deal with a sibling, with a brother or a sister. We have come to the point where we don't know how to deal with our own kith and kin, and we need to be taught by somebody. The point here is that science cannot solve social problems. Social problems can only be solved by people. And we don't need science in the present sense of science and technology to solve social problems. So even if science leads to problems, those problems cannot be solved by science. I said that in earlier thing, that you cannot solve a problem using the tools which caused the problem in the first place. I hope that answers the question.
All right. So it was really nice to have a very engaging and interacting audience for this evening's lecture. Thank you, one and all. A quick note before we conclude this evening, please follow Breakthrough Science Society Karnataka chapter on social media for news on upcoming events and interesting science-related content. We are on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Please share the content with your friends and family if you like it. Additionally, you can also become members of Breakthrough Science Society Karnataka chapter for participating in our study circles. Thank you all for your time and participation in today's event. Thank you once again, Mr. Vombatkere, for delivering this lecture, and JRL's family for extending all kind of support towards this event. Thank you again. You all in the audience, we are going to conclude this evening. Thank you for your time. Stay safe, take care, and good night.